the meeting of the Whately School Committee for January 9th to order. And the first order of business to approve the minutes of December 5th.
So moved.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor? Aye. Financial statements.
Okay, so I emailed you your statements. And I do have one concern at this time on the bottom of page 3. In the section, the third section up from the bottom, the transportation. We only budgeted $1,800 for special education, and it's going to run us $7,200 for the year. So we are $5,400 short. The good news is, so far on our regular transportation, we've saved $2,500 in fuel adjustment credits. So I'm hoping the remaining shortage will also be covered by the year-to-date shortage. The other thing that I have an issue with is that we had a placement of a homeless student from Greenfield in Whately, and our share of that transportation is $55 a day. That's difficult to budget, but I'm keeping my eye on it. I try to get an update today to see if they're still here in Whately or if they've found permanent residence yet, and we're waiting for Greenfield to call us back. So I am aware of now, I wasn't aware, but I am aware now of the issue, and I will be keeping an eye on it.
So I guess we'll stay on that topic. So the town of Whately pays $55 for somebody that we have to pick up in Greenfield?
No, the opposite. The child is a Greenfield resident. They became homeless. They were placed in Whately.
Okay.
So what has to happen is the town that receives the child and the town that where the child was from has to split the transportation.
So the kid's going to Greenfield?
Yes, they're picking them up here in Whately and bringing them back to an elementary school in Greenfield.
Okay.
And that's McKinney-Vento Act.
That's fine. And the other thing was the special ed, did we have a couple extra kids all of a sudden that we weren't figuring out or something?
No, what happened was we had, when we were doing the budget, we didn't have any. So we had the $1,800 as a contingency. And then the student went out and we remembered to put the tuition in, and we forgot to up the spend transportation when we budgeted.
So is that for, do you know if that's for one kid?
It's one child, they're in the sixth grade, so they'll be moving on to Frontier next year.
Gotcha. Okay. Thanks. That's all I have.
So the overall transportation budget should absorb that overage.
Yes. I'm hoping the fuel adjustment credits will continue to be as they have been, and we will save that money and make
it
up.
Well, we should be saving some money on electricity, I hope. We were told with the new LED lights it was going to save us a substantial amount of money.
And they're in.
So hopefully we'll save some money in electricity. So theoretically.
I just like to bring these issues as they come to my attention, I bring them to yours. And then tonight you also have 5 warrants to sign for a total of $37,361.18. And there was also payroll warrants for you to sign. The other thing I have for you tonight in my financial report is we did get our preliminary FY17 school choice report from the state, so I've given you an update there. It looks like we're down 3 students from last year. So our revenue is actually going to go down about $35,343 from 16 to 17. And this first page is the students that are coming to Whately, and you can see I total for you where they're coming from and what grade level they're in. And when we're looking at the differences in the grade levels, know that I compare this year's first grade to last year's kindergarten so that it is an apples to apple comparison.
It's amazing. We had 9 last year from Turner's and we have none for this year. Was that because of sixth grade?
I have to dig into this further. The same thing happened in Deerfield. We had 12 last year and none this year. I don't know if something's going up in that region, that they opened a new elementary or something, but it seems like everybody went back to Turner's.
Okay.
Well, some people moved from Turner's to Deerfield. That's the other thing.
Oh, okay.
So then they become residents.
That's true.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I know at least one.
I don't know what's going on there. The second page is our school choice sending. And right now, we're sending one more child than we did last year. And again, oh, my D's missing on Deerfield. And this is where they're going. Two to Conway, one to Deerfield, two to Hatfield, and one to Northampton. And the tuition's up about $10,000 on that. So that's the $76,000, that is the town's responsibility. The third page is the charter. And I have a call into the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education because, A, I didn't get the individual rosters, and there's a disparity in the two reports I get. One said there was one student, and in another one it said there were two students. But because the rosters aren't up, I can't tell if there's one or two. So I took the money as if there's still just the one, but there could possibly be two. What I do, once I get the rosters in for the school choice sending and the charter, is I send that list of last names with addresses to the town clerk to verify that they still are Whately residents so that we're not, the town is not paying for people who could have moved. So I do verify those students with the town clerk.
It's just amazing how much it is for 1 year. And that kid's a sixth grader this year and going to go on to typically go Frontier. And Frontier's going to have to pick up another 6 years.
So can you remind me where these numbers hit the budget then? So the first page is revenue that we're getting.
Right, and then we budget some expenditures against that.
Uh-huh.
And then the second and third page are on the town's budget. The town is responsible for paying that money.
So that's not representative here in our budget?
No.
Okay.
So we get the incoming money and the town gets the outgoing money.
Oh, okay. And where did the incoming comes into that fund?
The 003 fund.
So what did we budget for this year?
Well, we'll get to that when we look at the budget.
Oh, okay.
And that's later on in the agenda.
Okay.
And then the last thing I gave you tonight, we did send in the capital requests to the town. And when I sat down with Mr. Lesko, he was looking for $15,000 to do carpet. But when I asked him, how many rooms, he said 25%. So I said, so to do the whole school would be 60. So we submitted 60,000 over 4 years so that we do 25% a year for the next 4 years and get that on the capital plan for the town. And also they are showing on their schedule that our new phone clock and intercom system is scheduled for funding in FY18. And I did say to them that request is still valid. I was told by Mr. Domina that I did not need to resubmit that.
For 18 or 17?
18. So when they talk about it.
For next year?
Yes.
This is FY17 we're in now.
Right.
So it's on their schedule for next year.
So they, hopefully they vote on it in April.
For next
town
year?
Town meeting and be
for
able
next
to do
year?
It in June.
Right. And then we'll put it in July.
July 1st. After July 1st.
When you're saying 60,000 for carpet, are we replacing everything with carpet in here, or are we going to tile?
Basically, the first reaction, I have really...
I'm just asking.
The price is about the same either way, the way that most of the classrooms, places like the library, I think would end up being carpet again.
Yeah.
The classrooms have a portion of carpet and a portion of tile. From a pure maintenance standpoint, I would prefer tile. Speaking with Pete and Andy, the custodian here, Pete, the principal, they have reasons that they'd like to keep a carpeted area. So that'll be a negotiation, but I think the cost should work out about the same either way.
If you do tile, how will that match up to the stuff that's already in there?
Well, if we do tile, we would probably either do an alternating color or do the whole floor. But yeah, that is very much an issue.
And carpet versus tile for longevity is twice as much?
It's hard to...
Tile does last longer than the carpet.
Tile lasts longer.
It's more hygienic.
It's easier to keep really clean. But with that said, when you've got younger children and they like to be on the floor a lot, having a spot where they can have some carpet is something to be said for that.
Who makes the final decision Matt, you know, these are questions, I mean, I know my wife, more carpet I rip out of the house and for allergies and stuff like that, the better off she is. And I think it's the same thing with kids in general. If things are hiding in our carpets here, even though we clean them very, very, very well, you know, tile, to me, I think tile, I'm not sure about the aspect of maintenance with the waxing and the stripping and all that stuff and how long something that lasts. Is it do we do it twice a year for the stripping and the waxing?
Usually we do, we, you know, actually in the high school, we've been experimenting with some different methods and we've been getting it down. So in some of our areas, we haven't even had to do it. We've been doing it every other year.
Wow.
But that's a matter of taking really good care of it in between the application.
So to answer your question as to who decides, I would defer that to Mr. Skrosky because he's been a building principal. So
well, I would say the buck stops here, right here.
I mean, Pete's not here to say his piece. I mean, that's something, you know, I'm a tile guy. I mean, if I know what's hiding in these carpets, I don't care how well
my own principal's hat, I would say that teachers like carpet because it's a lot quieter. And the kids are on the floor a lot. So a lot of them end up bringing throw rugs in, and so you got carpet in the room anyways. But, I mean, I think it's a big discussion that needs to be
fully investigated. Yeah, one of the reasons, things that at Whately Christian Lane, the offices that really added to the air quality were all the carpets and
squares.
And yeah, moving to Frontier Regional was, you know, one of the big benefits is it's floors, we can sweep the dirt, we can mop them, we can burnish them, and you don't have that that problem. What teachers do if they want children on the floor is they have room size rugs, like 8.5 by 11, that are treated so that they're not, you know, they're flame retardant, they're great for schools, it's the requirement for schools. They're colorful, they have little spots for the kids to sit on. But from my perspective, I would advocate for tile with a room size carpet for the kids to sit on. The tile is just so much easier with spills. They have snack in the classroom. They have accidents where they, you know.
Yep.
I think it's unanimous here that it's tile, but.
Where's the cost for those rugs? Is that in the $60,000?
No.
That
comes out of a classroom material. That's a supply. It's a consumable.
An instructional material and supply.
Yeah. It wouldn't be. And they go from $300 to $400, but they last, you know, many years. But again, we clean them in the summer, but after a while, you can replace them a lot easier than you can afford.
I think my original estimates after conversations with Pete were based on replacing the carpet portion of the floors with carpet. We would have to also make a decision or probably run an experiment, a couple of classrooms with do we want to just tile the section that had been carpeted, or do we want to do the whole floor? And if we do the whole floor, that's going to change the economics.
I like what you were talking about first thing about having alternate color that goes together and stuff like that. And that's what we have now. We have an alternate colored carpet that goes with the tile that's in there. I mean,
we can try one or two of those and see how they work.
We have a classroom in this building. I think it's second grade. It doesn't matter, they've cleaned it, they've, you know, shampooed it. It doesn't matter what you do with it. It just
has a smell.
Yes, you know, and I feel badly, you know, for that.
Well, make sure grade two is the first one, or this one, whenever we get the money.
Yeah.
But anytime you can cut down on germs, dust mites, allergies with what's going on today, I'll give my 2 cents.
Well, we don't have the money in hand, so that discussion will be on the back burner, but I would hope that Pete would survey his staff too and see what they're looking at and have that discussion so that we can have a complete discussion here and not guess. Mike?
Yeah.
My gut feeling is the teacher's going to say they want the carpet. We'll see.
Okay.
But that's all I have for you tonight, and I'm sorry, I didn't know the school choice update was its own agenda under.
You asked to put it on.
I'm sorry, Patty.
I'll be more specific.
I got one question for you, though.
Yes, sir.
Last meeting, you were going to investigate the status of the generator.
That's also on their list for us to get in 18.
Is it for us or for them?
It's under school.
Okay.
Do you want me to say, okay, one of the things moving, I had to shut my Wi-Fi off because it doesn't work in the new building. But I have the schedule. I'll email that to you.
I'll be getting it Thursday because I'm on that committee.
Okay.
You could share with us.
Okay, I'll make a note to send you the email of the schedule.
Are there many other items on the schedule for the school?
For 18, it would be the generator might say 19. The 18, I remember the phone, the generator I don't pay a lot of attention to because it's really not our decision, I think might be 19, and then we're asking for rugs starting in 18, 19, 20, and 21.
So it's just those three items,
yeah,
really?
Right now.
Is there anything we got this year for you?
No.
No.
Nothing this year.
Let's see. I can actually.
Okay. Public comment. Seeing no public.
You have any comment?
No.
Okay.
Whatever you call them. Video.
Video master.
Graphic or whatever.
Cameraman.
You don't want to comment. Okay.
Cameraman.
All right. Thank you. All right. Update on school facilities projects.
Okay, I'll quickly go through the projects, and then I have another issue that I'm going to just kind of go over with you folks. The lighting project is 100% done. The town has the invoice, and I've told them I approve of it. They can go ahead and pay them. I think it's a great project. I mean, other than the fact the building is quite a bit brighter than it was before, you really don't notice anything. It was exactly the project I thought it would be. It went quickly. If we had done the drives and stuff, I was worried that it was going to drag out because it was a more technical project. With that said, the other project that we started earlier, the energy management system, is wrapping up a little bit late. We're doing the final walk through the equipment and testing everything and getting the last few things installed this week. And I just talked with Brian, the fellow from the Green Communities is probably going to come out Tuesday or Wednesday of next week to look at it. And they already have submitted us an invoice for that project too. So both projects went really well. I was surprised on both of them how well the contractors worked in the building being occupied, especially for the lighting. They sent a great crew up here and they went right through the building pretty quick and it worked out really nicely.
So can you remind me the extent of the project? So they replaced all of the light bulbs?
In this building, they did all of the classrooms, the offices, this room, the corridors. The cafeteria, what they didn't do was the gym. We had already done the gym. So, we've got absolute state-of-the-art. Actually, I think it's the only school in the district that has, we've got a few LEDs in the parking lot and other places. But the lighting in this building now is just absolutely super efficient. And again, they had to replace a few fixtures, but most of them they were able to modify the lamps and ballasts and put them right in these fixtures, and they came out real nice. And I think if you don't come here every day, you don't notice it.
But I thought it was brighter when I came in here tonight.
Yeah, tonight.
Considerably brighter.
It doesn't seem any brighter in here to me. I don't know.
Well,
might be your glasses, Don.
This is the only room. There was some negotiation with the person in here, and this entire library is not LEDs. Some of the existing fluorescent lamps were kept.
Because of problems with installation or just not?
Some people don't prefer.
I don't, I had a hard time, and I, Pete had an issue with the teacher, and he resolved it by allowing her to keep the lighting. And I wasn't too much a part of that decision, but it was really his decision.
So did that reflect in a reduction in the cost?
They put new fluorescent lamps in, and they also didn't charge us for some, there was some discussion about some work that was going to be done, some things that got missed in the bathrooms and other places when we did the original estimates. And so they didn't charge, you know, one kind of washed out the other.
And long-term, this should lower our electric bill, you think? And the replacement cycle is longer?
If I look for it, there's, the lighting is supposed to show almost a $4,000 a year decrease, annual decrease in our electrical.
And the longevity of the bulbs are?
Is longer, right?
Ten, I'm not going to say 10 years, but they say 10 years. So that's really good.
This is a leap for me because I've never put in a lot of LED lamps in a classroom setting, and I think it came out awesome. It came out really nice. I'm very happy with it. The energy management system is basically something that it's taking control of all of our heating, ventilating, and air conditioning in the building. And that also is projected to have a yearly savings. So we should do really well, hopefully, on the electrical this year. And pretty much the entire cost of both projects was picked up through the green communities. For the town, so it was a good deal.
So we'd get about half a year's benefit this year.
And you know, the town in the end was happy. We negotiated back and forth quite a bit, trying to use up, they wanted us to use up exactly that amount of money. So we were backing and filling several times, trying to get it to the number they wanted. And we were able to make it work out so that they used up just exactly what they wanted.
Good.
Okay.
What else you got for us?
Well, the other thing I've got for you is we participated in the district. There's been a fair amount of discussion in the state. They found a couple of schools that had some severe lead in the water and such. And there's two ways to test for lead. Here, I'll give you this while I'm talking. There's two ways to test for lead. One is what's been done conventionally for years, and that is the supplier of the water tests it as it's coming into the facility. But also they've found facilities that have lead in the water that's introduced actually within the building. So the state funded a program where they tested every potable water outlet in a facility at no cost to the facility. So there was surely a cost in paperwork and running around working with them, but the testing didn't cost the district anything. Where I'm headed with this is we're starting to get the results now. And out of 55 locations that we tested here in Whately, we had one location that came in above the state action level. And we're going to have to respond, or we should respond to the people in the town as to what we found and what's going on, because DEP publishes these results. Basically, we went through this building, we tested 55 locations, anywhere anyone could possibly get the water that was drinkable, and we took two tests. We took a sample of water immediately out of the fixture when we turned it on, and then we ran it for 30 seconds, and we took another sample. The first sample would indicate if there's a problem within the fixture, and the second sample would indicate if there's a problem somewhere down the line. The one fixture that came back above the state action level was a kettle in the kitchen that gets very little use. If I had had a, if I had thought more about it prior to it, or the state had warned me, I would have flushed every fixture in the building a week or so before we did the test, and this wouldn't have came back with lead in it. Basically, there's a faucet that feeds that kettle. In talking with the custodian, he felt that that thing hadn't been used in the 2 years he had been here. I talked to the people working in the kitchen. They kind of confirmed that. So when they first opened that, they got, you know, rusty, dirty water. Mm-hmm. And then when they flushed it for 30 seconds, it went clear and it was fine. Mm-hmm. What we can, as I spoke with the people in the kitchen that work here, they said that they didn't, you know, they didn't care one way or the other about that kettle. It's not something they use regularly. When I talked to Deb Zanowski, who runs the kitchen, she said her experience is the town occasionally uses it when they have big events here in the building.
And make spaghetti and stuff like that.
It's a very expensive piece of equipment. The valve that serves it, the faucet, is something inexpensive. So my recommendation, what I would recommend we do to resolve this is we replace, right now I've got it shut off. I recommend that we replace the faucet that serves it as a precautionary measure. I still honestly don't think that there's contamination in our system. I think it's just something that built up over a year or so by sitting there.
So it's not, is the lead stuff coming from the faucet, or is it just a buildup of through the water over the years that's building up somewhere in the line or in the pipe?
Either or, that's very difficult to ascertain. Either way, the most proactive thing we can do is replace that faucet. The most logical culprit would be the faucet. Mm-hmm. But again, if there was lead anywhere in the system or even outside of the system, and it was accumulating, and if that happened to be a low point or something, and it accumulated there, that's where it showed up, that's where the test was. So I think the prudent thing to do is to replace the faucet, just to be sure, to set up a policy in the kitchen that they flush that faucet once a week for 30 seconds, just to keep it clean, and that we retest once or twice, and call it a day.
So there's only one out of the 55?
One out of 55.
Same water you have for this school? Is that your house too?
Yeah.
And where does it come from, the water?
Town.
Up above? Up in West Whately, does it come across?
Yeah.
If you read the document they'll basically say there's lead in all kinds of water everywhere. And, you know, if given some time to accumulate, it will, and it'll show up.
I'll tell you right now, that what you said is exactly right on. That thing is rarely used. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you got a little lead in the water, it doesn't surprise me that it, you know,
accumulated
in that faucet.
So the flushing aspect
takes care of that? I don't think the cafeteria uses that. I haven't seen it ever used other than, as you said, as
spaghetti dinners.
Yeah, that's it.
Making big pots of spaghetti.
Yeah.
Yep. And, you know, the ladies that work day to day in the cafeteria said there aren't things in our way. We'd almost rather see it gone. But it is a valuable piece of equipment, and it's not the pot that created the problem. Right. It's just a little faucet that feeds it.
So Sunderland's in need of one. Can we sell it to them? Do we need it? I mean,
if you're saying we don't need it here, and Sunderland's in need of one, why don't we sell it?
Well, I can give you a sidebar on that.
I didn't know
that
Sunderland was in there. What they're in need of in Sunderland's the little bit.
Oh, it's not the same piece?
Not the same piece. Different piece of equipment.
Oh, all right. Dave.
When Holyoke Equipment bid that out in the kitchen, in the specs, we asked for that particular kettle, and mm-hmm. they left it out of their, they didn't figure it in their bid.
Oh, no.
And they came back for a relief. And we said, well, sorry, but, you know, we can't do that. So we ended up with, you know, we got that.
But the risk for the children and the employees and everything is very, very low, is what I hear you're saying.
Little or nothing.
They never use it, so.
Well, nobody's been using it. There was no exposure.
So it's not even like the water's going anywhere.
And nowhere else in the building. Even if we had, flushed that a week before, it wouldn't have shown up.
Right.
And this would be a moot point. But I do think that if you read this letter and you're okay with it, it probably should eventually be sent by myself or the superintendent to all of the occupants in the school and the parents at home, so they know what's going on. Just the first page with the attachment. The first page is something we've written. The attachment is something that DEP puts out, and it's a nice. But I think it's better to be proactive.
Yeah, I appreciate you doing that. Now, will we be testing regularly now that this is sort of a new thing that's out there?
The town every other year regularly tests the water coming into the building.
Right.
We were offered this opportunity to test every outlet to see if there was maybe some problems. We found one potential one. We'll fix it. I don't recommend testing to the extent that the state just did. It's a big deal. It's a lot of work, and it would be a big expense. I do recommend that after we replace this faucet, we check it once or twice just to be sure that everything's okay.
Is it a simple? Is it as simple as putting a Steri-Strip in there and just, you know, doing it like that, or you have to send it somewhere?
Yeah,
the testing they put us, the thing with the state was very elaborate.
Yeah.
You know, we did a whole big deal where we came here. We had huge coolers full of samples. We took, you know, we sent a coolers and coolers of vials of water out of here, and they,
wow.
I don't know exactly what they did, but they sent it to a lab, and the lab tested it.
And the state paid for it.
Yeah, that's good. Thanks.
Good.
Thank you very much.
It was very proactive of Bob to do this.
Mm-hmm. All right, anything else for Bob? I don't want to hold you up any longer.
Yeah.
You can help.
Get home and have some supper.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So the committee agrees that we can send this letter home?
Mm-hmm.
You approve? Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you, Bob.
Well, oh, sorry, just one thing. Would we want to wait to make sure that everything's fine before we send it out?
I would say this
is
kind
worried?
Of, no, it, if we have additional issues, we would do an additional letter. I mean, this summarizes
where we are
to now, and I think we want to get this out as quick as we can, because what the state said to me when they sent me the results is you should inform your community because these results become public in 2 weeks.
Well, it's public now.
Yeah.
Right here.
Right,
so.
That's true.
So
we're not
really
hiding.
No, we're not.
So we're
hiding.
Sending the letter rather than having them read it in the recorder when the recorder asks for all the results.
And if something else comes up, then we'll deal with that.
That's right.
Right.
And I think there was stories recently because I think
Amherst
had issues. So yeah. I'm sure the newspapers are going to be looking for these.
I'm
results.
Guessing just about anybody that tests is going to come up with one here and there.
That's true.
Thanks, Bob. Good night. We'll see you in the morning.
And I had one thing to add. At the last meeting, it probably should have went under old business, but at the last meeting, I said that I would check with Keith Bardwell about how much money will be made available from the insurance company to use towards the plantings and the stump removal. And his estimate is roughly about $60,000. He'd like for us to meet with Chris Frank to get a formal quote. So I'm not 100% sure what the insurance company is providing, but I think it's somewhere in the area of $60,000.
They also, we had an issue with our parking lot light, and when the electrician came to see why it was out, it had melted. So Keith had Mr. Lesko give him those invoices to repair that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
So,
that just seemed like a lot of money for
trees?
Yeah, for trees.
Bushes.
Yeah.
Have you been to a
nursery
release?
Yeah, I have.
I would.
Can't we just have everybody bring their Christmas trees and we can plant them?
Pile them up?
I'd like to arrange a meeting with Chris Frank, Kevin Keith Bardwell, rather, and Don and Bob, Katie, anybody, you know, who wants to?
Really can't do nothing till spring anyway, wouldn't you? I mean, you can't do any planting till spring.
No, but we can get our ducks in a row, ready to go.
See how much it'll cost.
Yeah.
Right, and what are we looking at?
You know, where are we going to start? Where are we going to end?
Well, we know what we have to do. We have to remove the stumps that are out there. That's got to be done before you can plant.
Is that a town thing? Can the town take care of that for us?
Well, that's what we need to talk to Keith to do it, or...
I would say at no expense, I mean, unless there's a charge to the insurance company for removal of the stumps.
Well, they worked a deal, if you recall, that Keith took down the trees.
Right.
And we got the deductible taken off.
Okay.
So, I mean, not negotiable, but that's what we need to talk with Keith about. If he's going to do it, then it'd be charged back to the town, to the insurance company.
If I can arrange a meeting on a Tuesday morning, would you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I defer to you guys, because it's hard for me to get here on Tuesday morning.
Well, you know, I would have them with Keith.
And Pete will probably be involved.
Yeah, oh, definitely. So, okay, great. I'll set up a meeting. I'll try to set up a meeting for Tuesday.
Yeah, because we're going to have to know where our exact property line is and the whole business, you know. But there's good drawings, I'm sure.
And...
I mean, it depends on, you know, if the trees are here, and we're coming 1 foot more, 2 foot more for a year, you know, if they're arborvitae's and they're just drilling and putting the pot, you know, putting those things in, may not even have to remove the stumps. The stumps will just...
I don't know.
The stumps may just decay. They're pine, so it's not like oak that are going to start sprouting sprouts or anything.
No, but
like
you've got roots there that you got to contend with, so. And those are some pretty big trees, so. I imagine there's pretty good root system. I'm not an arborist, but that would be my guess.
And the idea is that we probably won't get that land anytime soon, which is why we're moving ahead with this.
Don't see that happening.
No, they said no. And I guess Chris Frank is an arborist.
Yes, he is.
So that's, we're going with his expertise.
And, you know, the other thing we need to investigate, I mean, we're not paying the bill, but I don't want anybody, any pushback that we need to get quotes from other companies, and, you know, I mean, that needs to be asked, too.
Well, the town's paying for it, so it would have to go through Brian. We're not doing, it's not our money.
Exactly, but I'm just saying that...
Are they going to have to get three quotes?
I don't know.
$60,000 would have to be a bid, would have to be a proposal. So we could, I think they can hire, it's Chris Frank. Chris Frank. It always throws me when people have two first names. He could probably give us what we should plant, and then Brian might have to put out a proposal for the...
That's what I'm wondering. I'm just asking a question.
Great. So we'll have a meeting, and then we can...
Okay, anything else on that?
No.
Okay, moving right on, I guess we're in for the FY18 budget. That's always exciting.
No, but Patty will go through it. We worked on it this afternoon, and she compiled all the numbers. We went through. I had questions. She answered them, took care of them. So I'm going to let her present it as only she can do.
Okay, so our first page is just our introduction, and then the second page, we added last year who the members of the committee were at the time. The page marked 1 of 22, this is a new page that Dr. Carey asked us to...
Is it DES or...?
Oops. That one was already formatted, sorry. Thank you. It should be WES. I changed it up, Tom. Oh, darn.
Well, that's, you know what, Blaine, that's what it is.
I'm sharp. I'll tell you right now, I'm sharp.
You can't walk down the stairs, bud.
I may be old, but I...
That's what I'm saying. You can't walk down a flight of stairs, but you can. You notice all my typos. So this is, we're calling the student and staff data sheet, and it just gives us a snapshot of where our student population is this year and where it's projecting next year, and also changes in our staff. And a couple things still need to be filled in. One, Mr. Crisafulli is going to be giving me goals from the school improvement plan to put up in here that addresses what the budget is supporting. And then I will also put in a count of how many teachers we have at each of our levels of our contract. So that's what, and right now we don't have an estimate kindergarten enrollment. I believe starts, is it this week?
Yeah, they're working on it right now.
It went out, the email went out today.
Okay, so what? So what, the seven you see there, those are my PKs that I know are moving up. So that's why it says seven for 2018, because I got that from our early childhood. So then page 2 of 22 is our favorite summary page. And you can see that our budget is increasing $42,179, or 2.64%. We started, and this is strictly our town appropriation, we started this year with $1,599,454. Salary-related costs, $14,291 is the steps for IAs and teachers. We have a collective bargaining agreement 2.5% increase, which is $19,311. Other contract changes, $5,570. There was an increase in the lead teacher stipend that was $1,100. And we have $761 in here for non-union salary increases. Well, now more than $761, increased by $761 for the non-union raises. Other operational increases, we have an increase in our central office, and this is a twofold. One, Whately's percentage went from 9.11 to 9.21. And also, we lost some grant funding that supported two salaries, not full salaries, partial salaries. So partial grant funding, and that funding was lost. So those salaries had to come on. A new position was also added when we went to the Power School and away from Redeker, which is our student information system. They decided they wanted one person that did the APINs and SIMS reporting, and so that person came onto this payroll. The other thing we have is...
Who decided that?
Marty. At the request from the request of the technology director. We were having all kinds of problems with our transmission.
So Marty added staff on our own?
At the central office.
Interesting.
How does the ratio get calculated?
That breaks down, that's
in
here.
Page.
So that person on page 22 of 22, Katie, is all the allocations, and that one would be the last block. And that's based on the student population up above.
And so that's based on this year's population.
Right, from last
year.
Correct, this year to that. So that's where you see this year where Whately's 911 and next year it's 921. School committee expenses, $1,150. We have a small increase in our legal contract. And also, there's $1,000 added for our collaborative dues. This is something that's never been budgeted, and every year the bill comes and everyone says, where are we going to pay this? Where are we going to pay this? So this year we're adding it to the budget because it's something we pay every year and we just never have any budget money for it.
Where does it go?
Pete has been paying for it out of a REAP grant, and it's not a REAP appropriate expense.
Uh-huh. So it's in the school committee expenses?
Yes. Our library software went up $50. Principal office expenses, $4,920. This is a $1,000 increase to our advertising, and $3,900 is what we also have for the copier in the principal's office. And again, this is something that we incur these costs every year, and we're just going over budget. So this year we're adding it to the budget. Textbook expense, $3,405. This was something that we put to school choice. Mr. Crisafulli would like it back in the town appropriation budget. Our technology softwares are up $4,466. Our transportation, this is regular transportation, the contract will go up $476. and the increase in building securities and inspections. Mr. Lesko and I have been working on this. We have an amount appropriated for building maintenance, and but within that is all our inspections and all our security costs. So we wanted to break it out and give it its own line. So we're spending about $14,000 a year. So now we're going to have our maintenance line be just for maintenance, and this line will be just for our regular contracts for our fires, our alarms, our pest control, and things like that.
There's not enough in the budget to cover that?
No.
So you're asking for that money mm-hmm. in addition to breaking it out?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why we wanted to break it up so that we could add a new line item to the budget. We do have two decreases. Our retirement, when someone retires, they have a buyback. We did have someone leave last year but did not give us notice in time, so their buyback is due in 18, which is $10,349 less than the ones we had previously. And we do have one student in and out of district placement in sixth grade, so we reduced by $27,000 for a total decreases of $37,349. Or a total net change of an increase of $42,179. Pages 3 through 11 are just the detail of what I just summarized for you. And you can look at that.
I have a question.
Yep.
In June, we talked about what we're going to do in the cafeteria because we're running deficit. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we talked about was putting the salaries of the cafeteria workers into the budget. Is it in here?
No, it's not, because we were at 2.64, so I didn't know how far you wanted to go. Now I can do that.
Well, that's what we asked, because I'd like to see what that's going to do to the budget.
Okay, so I can do that.
And, you know, I would break it out if we even paid for one, you know, do both, but
sure,
what would one do
yeah.
to kind of offset some of that cost? But
okay.
I don't want to be sitting here in June scratching my head saying we got $9,000 we owe in the cafeteria and we've got no money left in our budget and then we're pulling from school choice again. I don't want to do that.
My pen just does not write on this paper. No, there's plenty of ink in the pen. It's not writing on the paper. It's this cheap copy paper.
Oh, that's
okay.
I'll get you one of my good ones. Start
nope, this works.
Okay.
Okay. And we'll see what that increases it by.
Yeah.
Okay. I can do that for you.
Yeah.
Okay. So that was through page
3 to 11.
3 to 11. And then starting on page 12, this is all our funding sources. So when you're looking at this, the town appropriation is the previous pages, and then the other three funding sources that we have, so that you've got a total FY17 budget. So you can see what we're expending on each category. And that runs through page 19. That runs through page 20 of 22. So if you look at that last page, we're actually going to be projected to spend $2,010,654 for FY18, and it says 17.
You lost me here somewhere.
Okay, go to page 20 of 22. And on the bottom page, so from the town appropriation, there's the $1,641,633. School choice, $328,232. The early childhood revolving, $17,000. And then we get $23,789 for a salary out of the SPED, $94,142. So even though we're requesting from the town $1,641,633, we'll actually be spending $2,010,654. So now let's take a look on page 21 of 22. This is our school choice. The first two columns is what we projected we were going to spend this year and what we're now looking at for 17. So looking at the bottom line, last year we thought we'd be in a deficit of about $148,000. That's gone down to $24,373. And what's not on here, which I also have to put on, is I believe you approved $1,800 for the snow blower. So that has to get adjusted. I don't know why these things come to me. And then in the box on the right, this is what we're going to be projecting for 18. So we're going to start the year $24,373 in the hole. The revenue is $228,870, and that's the number I used on the FY17 preliminary that I presented to you earlier. And then these are the scheduled expenses. We have teacher specialists, 1.2 FTEs, $80,453. And then regular instructional assistants, $138,851. Special education assistant, $22,624. And our speech therapist at $71,922. So the total expenditures is
$313,840.
And $109,000. So once again, we're no longer spending a year in arrear, we're spending a year and a half. And the school choice number here is wrong. I got to tie that number.
That's a lot of money.
It is. So that's why when I looked at the salaries, I didn't know, before I put the cafeteria salaries on there, I didn't know if you wanted to look at reducing school choice first before putting the salaries on. But I can do both.
With the new preschool in here?
The new preschool is not in here because it's really not going to cost us any additional money.
Okay.
What I didn't do is any projections on the revenue it could bring in.
We put in the $17,000 that we're getting
now. For the salary.
Right, which is what we normally do, is charge part of the early childhood salary there.
Right.
But we're hoping that the revenues.
There's no additional costs, really, because they're reallocating the positions.
Correct.
But there might be more revenue coming in.
Correct. And then we would put more expenses there. Now, the other thing, too, we can propose, Mr. Skrowski, for the committee's consideration is, when we get to the end of this year and we have monies, what we can do is take the summer salaries of the school choice and use, you know, any excess money to pay those school choice summer pays. So that would put more money in school choice.
What are we paying in the summer out of school choice?
People get paid 26 UPAs a year. That goes over the summer.
I mean, just temporarily move employee salaries.
Right. So let's say I'm a person and my salary comes out of school choice and I'm going to get $4,000 over the summer. Instead of paying that $4,000 out of school choice, if I have excess money in the appropriation, I would switch their salary over there, freeing up that $4,000. But I also know that you wanted to consider some projects on Bob's Mr. Lesko's list.
And that's not a given that there will be money left at the end.
Correct. I'm going to assume there will be because of, as Mr. Skrowski said, we should have some electricity savings and maybe some heating savings.
But on school choice, if we're $24,000 in the hole and we start off the next year with that $24,000 in the hole, and we only bring in $228,000. And we only have 204 to spend. By the bottom line, we got 109. So that's four times more than what we went into deficit going into FY18.
Mm-hmm. But it's still better than what we thought we were going to be this year. So we're no longer spending a year in arrears. This isn't a cash flow problem because the money will be at the town. We're not truly spending in the negative. We're just spending ahead of what we always thought we wanted to do.
Mm-hmm. But for all intent purposes, what could hurt this? One kid that has to go out of district, and it could change that number drastically? One kid?
The school choice.
I'm talking about if we had to pay for a kid to go out of district, at $100,000 or $125,000 a year.
We would have to go back to the town for an additional appropriation if something like that happened.
But if the school choice dropped off considerably next year.
We need to, so that's what I'm saying, we need to, right, we need to start thinking, do we want to, you know, do we want to take the chance that next year we're going to get more school choice kids? Or do we want to split the difference now and ask the town for a bigger increase this year?
Because the school choice has been going down, it seems like.
Yeah, we've gone down.
We've gone down quite a bit, so the trend is not good on the school choice.
But we're paying more still for the same services that the school choice is going to do.
But this is the problem with using school choice for these expenditures, because your school choice is locked at 5,000, but our salaries, 2.5, it was 1% for this year, 2.5 for next year, 2.5. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing, unless we bring more students in, there's nothing to perpetuate the growth of revenue.
So going down just exacerbates it because of that issue.
I think the more, like Don was saying with the cafeteria, where the more that we can put on the budget and have to depend on school choice to make this number better over here, to put more over here. Now, if we didn't have somebody telling us by the last minute about retiring at $10,000, and if we didn't have that kid going on to Frontier, we would have a pretty huge budget here, because we're looking at two numbers that is 2.34, and we got increases of 4.98 between the two tops. If we didn't have that, then we would, I'm not gonna say we'd be up the creek without a paddle, but.
So if you go to page 11 of 22, and right in the middle of the page, I'll wait till everybody gets there. Under the number 5150, so we had a $10,349 decrease in the retirement buyback. That's still $12,905 for this year. That won't be there next year. So that's money we'll pick back up next year. So that's part of bringing an IA salary back over next year. Seeing if I don't know, I haven't spoken to people. We have no notification of anyone retiring.
I'm gonna be stupid when I ask this question. Is there any IAs in the regular budget, or is it all school choice?
I believe there's a couple.
Okay. I'm being stupid.
No, so that's why. Okay, so I'm gonna direct you to this page, and then you can see.
Yeah.
This is why I like this page with all. If you go to page 14 of 22, and this is all funding sources,
Yeah. You
can see on the bottom, the last block, number 2330, instructional assistance, Yeah. There's $72,117 in town Yeah. Appropriation and $161,475 in school choice and another $23,789 in the SPED grant. So you can see in totality, we are spending $257,381 on IAs. And if you look at that staff's page that I gave you, page one,
Yep. I
believe we have 11 IAs. Yes. One of 22, there's 11. So for 11 IAs in the building, this is the total that we pay. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So that's our first look at our budget, and the last page again is the allocations based on enrollment. So our next meeting, would you like me to make the changes for the cafeteria and get those out to you before the next meeting so you can look at the summaries at that?
You could send an email or something.
Sure, I can do that. Do you want all the documents or do you just want that summary page to see the bottom line?
What do you mean by all the?
The percentage.
Do you want me to redo this whole document, or do you just want to see that page? I add the salaries, and it'll show up on this page that shows the 2.64, this page.
That's fine. I mean, that's fine with me.
Okay. And did you want to see a scenario where we take a little more money out of school choice as well?
Take more out where it goes into the budget?
Yes.
Can I just ask one question on the school choice? Is there a chance there will be other expenses added into school choice before the end of the year?
The only thing.
Cafeteria deficit?
That'd be the only thing, Katie. That'd be the only thing.
Right, so that could make it even a little bit worse.
Right. But not by
couple
much.
Thousand.
And I'll have February, I'll have the February meeting, I'll have a school lunch update as to how we're doing for the first 5 months of the year. Because I'll have September, October, November, December, January.
So that's really the only risk in here in terms of
correct
other factors.
And again, that could also come from our town appropriation if we have excess monies, if we have savings in some budget lines. Mm-hmm. We don't have to take it out of the school choice. We can take it from anything we have some budget line savings.
You said we had 11 IAs?
Yes.
I got another question.
Mm-hmm.
On page 22, mm-hmm. you're giving me allocations for each town.
Right.
I'm looking, you said earlier Whately went up.
Right.
I don't see where it went up.
Look at the last block where it says Union Regional Superintendent's Office per cost percentage split. And in FY 17.
How come everything above that?
So the union budget comparison, those are just for the union, the costs that are for the union, like the bookkeeper that just does the union, the early childhood coordinator, our curriculum director, they only work for the union. So that's what that split is. And that did go down, the four town. But the union that caught the union split takes in Whately's kids in the elementary and Whately's kids in Frontier, combines them. And then the Frontier percentage comparison, the one in the middle there, John, that's the assessment. That's what the assessments of the Frontier budget are going to be based
on. So Whately's assessment to Frontier is going to go down then?
Yes, it is.
So that'll help.
Yeah. But the regional is Frontier, right?
The Frontier percentage comparison, that's the regional assessment percentages.
Okay. So part of the challenge is the overall population is going down for Frontier.
Yes.
So we're a bigger proportion of the smaller mm-hmm. pie.
Well, you went from Frontier. 60 kids in 16 down to 51.
But the overall total went down from 500 to 4.
So when other towns go down, even though you didn't go down as much, you're going to get that weight. It has to be redistributed because it has to come out to 100%.
Right.
It's got to go somewhere. And if I know you need some time to look at this. So, if you have questions, email me, because then what I can do is I can respond to everyone. If one person has a question, I can respond to everything. Just remember that if I send you an email with an explanation, we can't deliberate on an email because we can't make responses to that email, because then that could be considered deliberation and in violation of open meeting. But I can send you all the same information.
So what's the next step? So the next meeting, when do we have to we get another version next meeting?
Yes, and I'll send them out in the interim, and then you will have more discussion in February. And then, you know, depending on what the budget looks like at that point, we will have more time to redo, look at other things, do different scenarios. And then you'll have your public hearing in March with your meeting following. And at some point, I would...
No one will show up, excuse me.
True. But at some point, I would assume that the town of Whately will probably call us to present our budgets.
Of course, they can just all come here, the finance committee, the selectmen, all can come here, have a meeting.
And it works that way.
Kill two birds with one stone.
So can we go back to this nice new page, which I really like?
Yes, we can.
The one pager at the very front, number...
That's very clear.
One of 22, I guess it is. So one of the things we're struggling with is a declining population for Whately and for the district overall. And this is projecting sort of the next year problem coming, continuing, right? Because this is going from 129 students to 119.
Well, we're hoping, though...
Well, we don't know what kindergarten's going to be.
Hopefully, we'll get 10 kids in kindy. We're hoping.
Okay.
We don't know that. We have 15 this year. We may get seven or eight. We're hoping that will... And that would be great if they'd school choice in as well.
Right.
But we do know we have seven
in our,
already in
so
our
we
program.
So this is what sort of what we know. It's not what we're projecting, really.
Correct. It's only what I know at this
we
point.
We could end up very close to where we are today.
Mm-hmm. But the problem, I know where you're headed, Katie, is but we're even though we are having declining population, here at Whately, we only have one classroom at each one grade level.
Right.
There isn't much you can cut. There,
no.
You know, we only have one of everything.
Well, I guess I'm just thinking it would be helpful to have sort of a few years projected out, because then we can see, like, this eating into the school choice. When are we going to really be right on top of the school choice money coming in, right? Like, that's what's... Next year, we're going to eat through half of the current year, it looks mm-hmm. like. But then the following year, is it only going to keep getting worse and worse and worse? And so should we be making decisions now to avoid worse cuts later, potentially? I guess that's what I'm trying to understand. If there's things we can be cutting back on now that are easier now than they will be in 3 years.
Well, that's why I was asking how many IAs we actually have. And I circled two grades that have not a lot of kids in two of our grades, even mm-hmm. with school choice. You know, I'm not saying do we have too many IAs, but...
Or do we not replace people as people leave? Like, I think that's the nicer way to manage all of this rather than have to remove...
And that's certainly a conversation we can have with Pete.
Well, we did have the conversation with Pete. The only problem is Mr. Crispulli was out sick today. So when I went back to look at my notes, I do believe even with what we need for the new full day EC that there could be one...
Yes.
reduction
mm-hmm.
possible,
okay.
But I didn't want to put that
right,
in
right, and I don't want to go
spoke
there.
To
we
Mr.
don't have
Crispulli.
To.
Right.
Well, we had that conversation, and Pete is very good about, you know, he's advocating for his needs, but he's also very good about saying, let's be responsible with the budget, mm-hmm. and he's very good about saying that. And he did say, closer look. So that mm-hmm. would be another scenario mm-hmm. we would look at and put together.
So I'm going to confirm those numbers yeah. with him mm-hmm. upon his return.
And that could balance a little bit with the cafeteria salaries.
Right.
Yeah.
And if we don't probably want to do it this year, but the preschool, if the preschool does take off and could fund more of the salaries.
It will.
That would also
that's the goal,
alleviate a little bit.
Right.
Here.
That's the goal.
We probably want to be conservative in this first year.
Right. I don't want to do projections and then not hit them.
Right.
I'd rather say, hey guys, we get some money and then push.
We did that already once and it didn't
and we
work.
Failed.
Yeah, we failed.
Right, well, but if you have maybe a 3 year looking out, it might be a little easier to see some of those movements. I don't know.
Well, we have no idea. We'd have no idea with
look
kids.
At what happened with Turner's.
Yeah.
Those kids from Turner's there, it's, where was it? Yeah, wasn't there one? When did I see Turner's?
Yeah.
We lost. From
yeah, we lost from Turner's.
And other schools as well in the union.
And then projecting the enrollment, Katie, our own enrollment is hard.
Tricky.
I mean, I think in 1 year since I've been here, you guys, the town of Whately had two births 1 year.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it's just helpful sometimes to make scenarios and sort of see where the, how that impacts the budget.
I do know that Kim McCarthy is going to be interviewed by the Greenfield Recorder. So we're pretty excited, as we're actually taking in applications for next year for pre-K and kindergarten. So we're pretty excited about that. And hopefully that kind of publicity will help get it out there.
So that's all I have right now, unless you have any further questions.
No, just one comment. I mean, we decided to go a month later on these budgets, right? Essentially, because we used to get them in December. And I just don't like hearing that there hasn't been that discussion about the age.
There was a conversation. My notes are confused. I went to call Pete today, and he's not here.
Because, you know, I just feel like I'm hearing it's been thrown together, and I don't like that. It doesn't feel good with me.
We did have the conversation, and I'm almost positive we talked about that, and that we'll make that scenario. Without Pete being here, though, it's really hard to say for him. He may have, you know, something may have changed, but I don't think so. I think that will be one of the concessions.
So just to let you to explain to you the process, we started these budgets, I started the budgets in November, rolling forward all our salaries, and we started having meetings with the principals. And we had our first meetings with the principals, so I have five meetings with five different principals and with the superintendent. I take that data and I go back. Then I put everything together. Then we met with all the directors. And then I take that data and I bring it back. And then I make five budgets. Then we had our second meetings with all the principals. And again, that's five meetings again. So then when I get closer to the time of your meeting, I had Deerfield last week, now I'm compiling all the different things to make the final document. And my notes can get confused, and I don't always remember the exact conversation, what the conversation was. And then what threw another monkey wrench in here was the conversation about the early childhood. So these were not put hastily together. They were compiled today. The data's been working on, but I was compiling from three different sets of documents for our final budget, and that's where the error came in. And it's not really an error.
It's not really an error.
We're waiting for that one final okay from Pete.
But I just don't like hearing a year down the road we forgot to put something in.
I understand that. Yeah.
Well, and Don, that's why we've taken a lot of time going through redoing the chart of accounts so that we could, because that's what, when I first got here, that's what I had. It was all these budget numbers, but no, you know, what is that paying for? And then all these bills kept popping up, and I'd say, well, where's that budgeted? Oh, I don't know. So we redid the chart of accounts so that we say, okay, this now takes care of this, this, and this. And when a bill pops up, okay, that should go here. It wasn't budgeted for. So we now I have a file that says non-budgeted F16 expenses for FY17 budget. And now I have my FY17 that needed to go into the FY18 budget, such as the CES dues, the copier in the office. So is any budget going to be 100% accurate? I wish I could say it would.
I know better, but I just...
I would hope that I'm at least 95% accurate.
When we're talking of salary, I think you need to be accurate.
Absolutely. That's why I'd rather leave it in than take it out.
Anybody have any other comments or questions about the budget? I know I want to go home and look at this.
So can we request variations in between the meeting? And then
absolutely.
Idea of what else we might move from school choice.
Yes. Okay. And Katie, if you I know that you have a finance eye that's a little bit different than mine, but anything you want to see, you know, if you have an idea for a report that would make things easier for everybody, that would be great. I love, because that school, the school lunch one, just to put a different perspective
of looking at it
that made sense. So I love that you have that eye, and that input is greatly appreciated.
I like it.
Happy to do that.
Thanks.
I feel, you know, I do, because I really do, what you're saying, Don, I do feel like, I do feel that weight, like, what if I forget something? So the other eyes and hands help, do help, but then sometimes the notes get confused. So I appreciate all your support.
All right, so I suggest we take these home, study it.
Sharpen our pencils.
Anything else on that, Bob?
No, sir.
All right. Let's move on to reports. The only thing I have is, as I said earlier, the Capital Improvement Committee will be meeting on Thursday. I'll be in attendance. So I'll be able to tell you more how we're faring with our projects that we submitted to the town, so.
You can give them a bug in their ear about this generator for.
It is on there, I looked.
On 18?
Yeah, for 50, but again, for $55,000, when we know the last time we went out and priced it, it was $104,000.
Okay, I'm just.
So you might want to.
That's been one of my pet peeves for the last.
And Mr. Skrzydlewski, if you would please remind them of that, they have it on the schedule for $55,000, and the last time we priced it, which was 2 years ago, it was $104,000.
I know.
Danny is on that committee with you?
Yeah.
Because I've gotten a couple emails over the year about, you know, putting it on hold and stuff, so it just.
I did get the Wi-Fi to turn on, so I did already send you that email, so that you guys have that.
Okay. Anything on the collaborative?
I don't have any updates.
Okay.
What time is the
principal's
meeting?
Not here. What Superintendent.
Thank you. What time is the meeting on Thursday?
6.
6 o'clock. At the Whately Town Office. Great.
They go through the whole town, though. It's not just the school.
Yeah. That's interesting. The only thing I want to talk about this month, and it will be in my superintendent's message on the webpage, is that I want to discuss and just bring out in the open the process we go through when we decide on school cancellations and school delays. There was, you know, people ask me a lot and they'll say, well, we had a cold day several weeks ago and school was delayed for 2 hours. But it was a cold day today, we didn't delay. Well, what I'd like to explain is that it's not just one thing, it's not just the cold weather, it's the cold weather combined with the wind chill and the national oceanic and atmospheric.
Say that three times.
Noah.
Yeah. So when NOAA gives us warnings and or advisories, weather warnings or weather advisories, we need to really pay attention. And so the day that we had the delay for the cold weather wasn't simply because of the cold, it was the wind chill. And at the temperature it was, combined with the wind chill because of the high winds that day, anybody out there for 10 minutes would have gotten frostbite. And we think about the high school students who are out there at 6:30 in the morning waiting for a bus, and they're, you know, not dressed as well as, you know, they could be. But we take all of that into consideration. But we do understand that it's very inconvenient for families when we delay and or cancel. I like to tell them as soon as I even have an inkling. Sometimes I'll call the night before and say, please be aware. It could be a delay, it could be a cancellation, but be prepared to change your plans for the morning. There is a group of superintendents that I'm in, Franklin County superintendents that I work with. There's 8 of us. And they're from Greenfield, Pioneer, Mohawk, Irving, Orange, Franklin Tech, and Gil Montague. And we're all, this is my school phone, and we're all on there at 4 o'clock in the morning, and we're talking. Franklin Tech starts it because, of course, they pull from all the county. And we go back and forth, and then while I'm communicating with the superintendents, I'm also communicating with our town road superintendents. So, you know, Keith Bardwell, I'm on with him a lot. He's great. He's always answering my thing, you know, so 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, what's going on, how's it going, how does it look? But then we also have to consider Conway, which has a higher altitude, and then there's Deerfield and Sunderland as well. So with all that information, so the NOAA, the superintendents, the town superintendents, the road crews, I make a decision about 5 a.m. And when I make that decision, I notify Patty. Patty calls the buses and
TV station.
I make, I get on the computer, but I record a message to go to the homes for 6 o'clock, and I explain why we're doing it, and this is, you know, Superintendent Carey, and I'm doing this. And then I notify the principals and the out-of-school time and all the other things. But the decision doesn't come lightly. I know it's inconvenient for families when we make the decision. And sometimes I may get it wrong. It's possible I may get it wrong. So far this year, I've been right on, even though one person called the office and said, "This is what's wrong with America. You're delaying school because it's cold." But
it'd be different if you were the only school.
Right.
There was towns canceling school the night before of that advisory that you went 2 hours. I mean,
right.
Do you get a lot of feedback?
No, absolutely not. So I think so far this year it's gone well.
Good.
But I also want people to understand that it's not something that comes lightly or comes easy. It really, there's a process behind it, and I appreciate my fellow superintendents. We're all into communication, and now we're into Bitmoji, so we all have designed our face, you know, animated, and you know, we can do
this. Gotta lighten it up at 4 in the morning.
Right, and it truly is 4 in the morning. But it's an important thing to do. I'm hoping that, you know, I try to make the calls to come at around 6 a.m., so it's not too early, but it's also not too late for those high school students. And
when they hear the phone going off at 6 o'clock, they must know what's going on.
Right.
When that phone rings, what the call's for.
And it is much more convenient. Back in when my children were in school, of course, in the 80s, it wasn't, you know.
Look on the TV.
Yeah.
Is it going? Are we going to do it? Yeah.
Or, you know.
How come Frontier's not there yet?
I remember, you know, they closed the school. I lived up in a very rural, I lived on a farm, and it was a very rural area. And bus didn't come, so I put my kids in the car and brought them up to school. And, oh no, we had to close today because a pipe broke or something. And, you know, you wouldn't have a clue. But today, it's so much more convenient for families.
Technology.
Yes.
That's the question, though. There does seem to be, and I totally appreciate how hard it is to make the call at 4 in the morning, and who knows what the weather's really going to pan out. So I give you a lot of credit for having to make those calls. But sometimes the early release combination is confusing to people, and I think there's been some changes in the schedule. And I know you and I emailed at one point about that, but I don't know if it's worth sending out a sort of more of an overall communication that says, here's the calendar, just look at the calendar, and we'll let you know if anything changes.
At the last principal's meeting, I met with the curriculum coordinators, and I said, listen, I need to, you know, we really need to pin this down. So this is, this is what we came up with.
Because the kids seem to have one idea, and the parents have another, and the teachers. So we really need to be clear. And the grandparents, right? I wish I had grandparents.
Luckily, my schedule's flexible, so it really doesn't make any difference.
Yeah. So what we talked about was, and I had it in here. Let's see. Essentially, if there is. I guess the theory was beforehand, if there was a cancellation in the week, earlier in the week, then we would go full day, and there would be no early release on Friday.
Right.
Unless there was a presenter or somebody we hired to come in and speak. And what had happened this past one, on Monday, I believe we canceled school recently on a Monday But we said, okay, on Wednesday, I met with the principals. They said, well, let's just go with the early release. Okay, well, that was the Friday it was called, so it was a delay. Okay. Whenever there's a delay, there's no early release.
Can't be.
Or we'll just cancel.
Well, okay. If there's a delay and then there's early release, it doesn't count as a school day. There's just not enough.
And that's fine. I guess maybe just somewhere on the website, there's like that is spelled out for people so they can find it, what they need to know.
Okay, and I'll put that in my letter. But it is, it's hard to determine because each early release, some weeks there are none, and then other weeks there are. It might be parent-teacher conference. But essentially, we would probably honor the early release. I'm understanding from the curriculum coordinators that they would like to continue with the early release, even if there's a cancellation early in the week.
But that's my understanding. That's sort of like last year it was, if there was a snow day, they were automatically going to get rid of the early release. This year they decided they would keep the early release. But I guess my point is just we just need to communicate it clearly to everybody.
Or just have one of those robocalls go out.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
as soon as you kind of know what's going to happen that week.
And I think that's what happened last year, Katie, was that on one of the snow days that we canceled, we had speakers and we couldn't reschedule
right.
them. So
I understand why it's different. I'm not arguing for what we're getting.
No.
And I also think, I think Bob has a good point. If so that everyone knows, I could call on a Thursday night and say, folks, even though we had an early, even though we had a delay or
a cancellation,
we will be having early release tomorrow, or we won't be
or
having
we won't.
It.
Or when you cancel the school day, if you're doing the snow day, you could just say, and this means we're not going to have, or we are going to have, I don't know.
On that Friday, we were going to go with it, but then when I had to call in to delay it, I did say, and there will be regular dismissal today.
And that was clear, so that was good.
But it is, it's
adding a whole nother little wrinkle.
That's right. It's another layer of
confusion.
But I will make sure that on Thursday nights, if there's any activity during the week on Thursday nights, I'll make sure that parents and families
get
know
a reminder.
There's an early release or there is no early release due to the fact that we have this.
And I don't know how teachers are, but it seems like some teachers were saying one thing and other teachers were saying another.
Well, we also have to talk about time on learning. Mm-hmm. If we're canceling and then, so we also have to be aware of that. They're not changing the MCAS dates, even though we're changing our time on learning.
Yeah. You know what I feel about with the early release. So,
as we compromise to meet everyone's needs, and this is something we do, but that's a very good point, and I'll put that in my my notice too, that I will call the families on Thursday night. It's not a hard thing to do, and if I call at supper time, everyone will be up, So.
Yeah, don't do it at midnight.
No.
Oh, I forgot. I gotta go do that now at midnight.
So that's all I have. Thank you.
Make a motion adjourn.
We have a motion. We have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you.